First up, tonight, I have been excited for a long time for this session because it's literally going to blow your minds, right? Reggie, you ready? Starting out with one of my favorites, I have watched Jami transition and transform constantly. Every time we see her, she's got a new concept and she's developed it. And tonight, she's playing in a duo with Eliza Blue. And so, totally excited to kick off this incredible session with the Nesters. Welcome them.
Well, we are so excited to be here tonight. It's always a huge honor when I get to come back and play this festival. And to bring Eliza back to, and kind of like, I kind of get to present her to you, right? Because I've been here a bunch of times, and I always I get excited when I meet such fabulous musicians that aren't known to my home audience here in Sioux Falls, maybe. Or maybe you know who she is already, because she's already had quite a career touring out of Minneapolis. But we met about a year and a half ago and have been playing as the Nesters since then. And we started out with a hymn, hopefully, probably you know, something, a really familiar melody to you. And now we're going to play you one of our originals. And I guess the best way of introducing this song is telling the, you know, a little bit about the person who wrote part of it. So the song is called 40 Miles to Water, and a number of years ago I put out an album of songs from like the Dakota Territory settlement days, so late 1800s, early 1900s, the music that was played around this area. And while I was digging up that music, my family was telling stories to me about my ancestors and their trip to this part of the country. I wrote a song called Sodbusters based on that, and then this song never quite happened. It kind of missed its boat of that album. This song is actually told from my great-great-grandfather, David Huff's point of view. I've always been like fascinated with the women in my family history. That's kind of been, I guess, my shtick. And I didn't even learn his name until this year. The story goes that he and his wife Lydia were married in New England and got in a covered wagon and headed west, settled near Summit, South Dakota. He left her in Summit and went farther west to Lemon, South Dakota, up in Eliza's neck of the woods, and homesteaded out there. He brought a couple of his kids with him and left a couple with Lydia to kind of feel things out and get things settled before sending for her. And he was there for 2 years, and during those 2 years, he lost both of those children to what they thought was meningitis, and then threw up his hands and went back to Summit. But the story goes, and this is just the story. I don't know if this actually happened or if I have a clever storyteller in my family line, which is entirely possible. The story goes that he pounded a sign into the tree on that claim that said, before he left it, that said, 40 miles to water, 40 miles to wood. I'm leaving this damn country, and I'm leaving it for good. So he kind of actually wrote part of this song for me. It's kind of his letter back to Lydia before he goes to join her. Thanks so much.
So we kind of joke that one of the things that brought us together is the banjo. I mean, seriously, there's a lot of good things to say about a banjo. And so we are very excited to find each other and start playing together. And the other thing that sort of has brought us together is both a love of the prairie life and of the prairie narrative. So independent of one another, we've been writing these songs for years. And so it's been fun now to start working on them together as well.
And creeping each other out online for years also. I knew all about her prairie narrative. Like, there's this other chick that also plays the banjo and also writes prairie songs. And
we could either have become arch enemies or we could team up. Those were the only two choices.
This is like a superhero movie.
It's like the superhero girl banjo players. Yeah, banjo is my superpower. Anyway, so we actually did meet online. That is true. I asked her out on a date. I was like, "Do you want to like play banjo with me sometime? Maybe, is that weird?" So we got together and we discovered that we had a lot of songs that we'd worked on independently and even had played in some cases for years. And this one, for example, I started writing when I was living on the coast of Maine a decade ago. And it's just been kind of rewriting itself over time. And it wasn't until I arrived here that I discovered what the song was really about. It turned out it was about a pioneer woman. And it wasn't until I got Jamie and added her that I felt like the song was really done. So this tune is called Bury Me Deep.
This next song is based on a story that I stole. Isn't that a common theme in folk music? but the story behind this song is called God Out on the Plains. And so I got to give a presentation with Kevin Locke, who, if you're not familiar with him, he's a traditional Lakota hoop dancer, flautist, storyteller. He runs like 10 miles every day. He's a pretty crazy cool dude. In his presentation, he was talking about how, of course, the Black Hills are sacred to the Lakota people. And if before settlement days, before the Black Hills were settled and broken up, if you went into the Black Hills, you went as a pilgrim. You went there to either, you know, pray or see visions or look at the stars or just be out in nature. And you only stayed for 3 days because they believed that if you stayed for more than 3 days, you wouldn't appreciate the beauty anymore. And I can totally relate to that. I'm sure some of you can relate to that. If you live in a really beautiful place, you don't appreciate it as much as your friends or relatives that come to visit and they're like, oh, Spearfish Canyon. I'm like, oh, yeah, I get carsick. Like, it's you just kind of you lose sight of that beauty. So it kind of that thought and that idea kind of stuck with me. So this song is kind of loosely based on one of those pilgrims a couple hundred years ago heading to the Black Hills. You'll thank me later.
Closer in the hills.
so much. So you actually, if you were paying really careful attention, you actually heard this song already today, but I'm hoping you weren't paying that close attention. It was in between bands. I mean, pay attention during band sets, but we're going to play you a cover song now. Something else that we found we had in common is a lot of our favorite female singer-songwriters. We liked the same ones, and maybe some of them even a little bit rare, but apparently not that rare, because you guys played her in between sets earlier. I was like, shoot! We're totally upstaged by the original, because it's fabulous. But this song was written by Martha Scanlon. She played for a long time with a band called the Real Time Travelers. This was kind of like her first big hit, but now she travels under her own name with a band or solo, but she actually works in Montana for part of the year as a ranch hand. So she actually like does a lot of the things that she's writing about, which I think is really a original idea as a folk singer myself. I guess I write about a lot of things that I don't know anything about.
Well, and this is actually the first song we ever played together. It was we got together and it really was we just chat, and then I was like, well, now I guess we actually have to play. What are we gonna play? Now it's weird. So Jami said, do you know Martha Scanlon? And I was like, know her. So I love her. I actually stalked her for a while, but that's another story. And it's actually true. You could even probably ask her about me. She'd be like, yeah, I do remember that girl. It was like a long time ago. I had too much stage fright to play myself, so I just followed her around.
Still there, little bird of heaven right in my head.
Well, Eliza's going to play you one of her originals next.
So I don't know if you guys saw this. Before we were starting, we were performing emergency surgery on my banjo. That's the other reason it's nice to have two banjoists, because I had not brought my tiny screwdriver to tighten my pegs, but fortunately my bandmate.
How many of you carry tiny screwdrivers?
And I mean just gonna
tiny.
Say, everyone
I don't mean the kind that's in your car. I mean tiny.
If you play banjo, you probably do. All right. Well, this is a love song. It's called "The Song Without Words."
Let me make sure I'm in tune.
So while there's a lot of wonderful things about two banjos in a band, there is one downside. Tuning can be an issue. A little bit.
There's some good belly laughs.
There. Yeah, I know. You guys know what I'm talking about. Singing to the choir. Also, there's sometimes feedback that happens too. All right, here we go. Song without words. So this is a brand new one. I guess it had its,
I guess we've played it a couple times now since we've actually gotten an opportunity to play a few shows in a row, which
we're on tour right now.
Turns out, yeah, it's very helpful. But this song is yet unnamed, and it's I've really always had it since I was little, had an affinity for cowboy culture. And, you know, I was raised on a dairy farm, so not exactly cowboy culture, but my grandpa really loved classic country music and the cowboy music that came before that. Marty Robbins is really who first got me into the style of music. Long before Marty Robbins, there were the real cowboys that were actually working out on the open range and actually writing songs out there. And I've loved those songs, I've performed those songs. And this song, I suppose, kind of came out of that tradition, but getting to know Eliza and their lifestyle, ranching in western South Dakota, and other musicians who also ranch in western South Dakota, is kind of where the other part of this song came from. It's kind of like a more modern story of the cowboy, because things have changed drastically in the ranching industry in western South Dakota, and it's just harder and harder to make it work. I've heard that from so many people that live in the same way that Eliza and her husband do. So this is kind of a song of the modern cowboy, and especially this year during a drought.
So slow, gotta kick out some clouds that Stand in the garden and watch it get wet.
Thank you.
So we've been playing a bunch of shows in a row here, but they've all been long shows. So. Fortunately, they put a clock up because we don't want to be the reason that everyone else is late. So we're trying to decide. How are you guys feeling? You feel like you want to hear fiddle, like a fiddle tune, or you want to hear more banjo?
Should we just do these
last two then?
Yeah.
All right.
Sounds good.
All right. You got it. We got to give the people what they want.
Okay, with that comes an entire new tuning.
Yeah, oh. So while Jami tunes, I will tell you a story. So this next tune that we're going to do is actually, as also folk lovers like yourselves, I'm sure you can appreciate that it is part of the folk tradition to steal from other people. So we stole, part of this song was from a great folk band called Roma de Luna. And the tune is called Tree of Life. And the lead singer of that band had stolen it from the fiddle tune Cripple Creek. So we've taken her words, kind of made our own new melody, and then we slapped on an instrumental, which we're pretty excited about. So now we can call it ours, even though I guess it was definitely a group effort. Right? But that's what folk music is for. Taking other people's stuff and then taking credit for it.
That was like part of Exodus right there.
So the other, now I feel again like I'm preaching to the choir here, because I can tell there's a lot of banjo players and lovers out there. So you know that one of the things about being a banjo player is that you're supposed to learn jokes that you tell while you're tuning, which I am a complete failure at. So I've got one and one joke only. I'm going to bring it out right now. You ready? So what is the difference between a banjo and a fish? Anybody? I think I might have heard the answer. You can tune a fish. I always appreciate when people laugh. Thank you so much. Thank you. My work here is done. All right.
And
with
it is
that,
done, because I did tune a banjo.
Outdoor gigs, I mean, what's better than being outdoors? Nothing.
All right, except now you tune that thing. We save the best for last, folks.
As I was saying, it's like you bring these instruments made of wood outdoors into the woods, and they get a little crazy. It's like they're remembering how it used to be. They're like, ooh, it's nighttime. Time to get wild. says I'm getting funnier, so maybe we should keep... The longer she tunes, the better I get.
Might be a record for the longest tuning on stage ever at Folk Fest.
You gotta hold the record in something.
Thank you so much.
We are so proud of the immense talent that we have in South Dakota, musically. Young, especially, they're all throughout here, and a lot of it's because of the Folk Festival that these kids have developed and are up on the stage. We have young and old talent, right?